Don't copy nature, but control it. Speed up the elimination process.
Once they have been born, defectives are happier and more useful in these institutions than when at large. But it would have been better by far if they had never been born.
It's been tried before. The eugenics movement of the early 20th century aimed to stop the weak procreating through compulsory sterilization of the unfit.
Eugenics seeks to apply the known laws of heredity so as to prevent the degeneration of the race and improve its inborn qualities.
Here was a slippery slope down to a nightmare. At its worst, eugenics became a dark tribal vision, ultimately used to justify ethnic genocide in Nazi Germany, with horrific echoes in Bosnia and Rwanda. I feel strongly that the barbarism that was the culmination of eugenics in the 20th century was atrocious. But it's important to say eugenics is not Darwinism. Eugenics is not a version of natural selection. Hitler, despite popular legend, was not a Darwinist. Every farmer, horticulturalist, or pigeon fancier knew how to breed for desired outcomes. Eugenicists like Hitler borrowed from breeders. What Darwin uniquely realized was that nature can play the role of breeder. Darwin has been wrongly tainted. I've always hated how Darwin is wheeled out to justify cutthroat business competition, racism, and right-wing politics. And throughout my career, I've grappled with the apparent paradox of the way cooperation, being nice to each other, even morality, could evolve from the mindless brutality of nature. Charles Darwin argued in Origin of Species that evolution of life on Earth had been driven by a brutal struggle for existence. Natural selection can seem bleak for many biologists. Certainly, nature can be pitiless and cruel. But I've been intrigued by what appear to be acts of kindness in nature. Warning cries, huddling for warmth and comfort, and mutual grooming. Animals like these are displaying what we call altruism. They're giving something to another at a cost to themselves. The question I've grappled with as a biologist is why? The explanation must at some point involve the brain. Altruism, like any other behavior, must have evolved over time as brains have evolved. So now, I want to talk to somebody who knows about our evolved psychology.
Steve, hello, and welcome. Nice to see you.
When we teach about evolution, we naturally tend to focus on anatomy. But you could equally well say that psychology, that our minds are evolved organs or organ systems, couldn't you?
Well, yes, and we have every reason to believe that the mind is a product of the activity of the brain, and I happen to have one here. And it's clear that the brain is an organ. It's got an evolutionary history. All of the parts in the human brain you can find in the brain of chimpanzee and other mammals. And we also know that the brain is not just a random neural network. And we have reason to believe that a lot of the products of the brain, our perception, our emotions, our language, our ways of thinking, are strategies for negotiating the world, surviving, bringing up children, finding mates, negotiating relationships.
I suppose we can all understand why sexual lust has a Darwinian survival value. And are you now saying that the mechanisms for guilt, trust, that those are a bit like lusts? I mean, there's a lust to trust, or is that
Indeed, I mean, there are, and people have no problem accepting Darwinian explanations for emotions that are triggered by the physical world. Fear of heights and snakes and spiders and the dark and deep water. Disgust at bodily secretions that might be carrying parasites or rotting meat and so on. Often feel a little more surprised and even resistant to the idea that some of our moral emotions might have an evolutionary basis, like trust, like sympathy, like gratitude. But I think that as clear as it is that fear has an evolutionary basis, I think our moral emotions can be analyzed in the same way.
I think Steven Pinker is right and that we do have an evolved morality. But I also understand why there is resistance to the idea. Why would the genes for the parts of the brain that involve giving at a cost to oneself be inherited in nature's brutal struggle for existence? To explore this, I want to look at another case where individual survival doesn't appear to be the priority. A peacock's plumage is gorgeous, but it must get in the way of its own survival. It's easily spotted by predators, and its huge weight must hinder a quick escape. So, why isn't the peacock's tail eliminated by natural selection? Charles Darwin was puzzled. "The sight of a feather in a peacock's tail, whenever I gaze at it," he wrote, "makes me sick." But it was Darwin himself who hit upon the answer: sex. The peacock's tail is a burden to himself, but a boon to the genes that built it. Why? Because the tail wins sexual partners. Something about the peahen's brain is attracted to bright feathers and extravagant, maybe costly, advertisement. Peacock evolution has been shaped not just by individual survival, but by peahen brains. Peahens, in effect, selectively breed peacocks, as pigeon fanciers breed pigeons. Darwin defined this as sexual selection. Evolution, he now realized, wasn't just about which animals survived, but which could prevail in winning the favors of the opposite sex.
There are two ways for an individual to pass its genes on to the next generation. You've got to survive, and you may have to be attractive to the opposite sex. A peacock is a walking advertising hoarding. A peacock's tail, with its eye spots, is like a walking neon sign.
Here in America, I'm looking into an unexpected way in which women could be said to be practicing a form of selective breeding. I'm going to meet some single women who, in the cold light of day, are choosing the attributes they want to mate with and hope to pass on to their children. Is it even possible that kindness, altruism, is one of the things they go for?
Hi.
Hello, you must be Stacy.
Yes, I am. Welcome.
I'm Richard.
Very nice to meet you. Come in.
And this is Amy.
These women want to become mothers through a sperm donor. It's a kind of high-tech sexual selection.
Thank you very much for... Did you think you were choosing a man that you yourself might have been attracted to?
Absolutely. Yes. I mean, it's a little bit, I joke, it's a little bit like going on Match.com. You pay for a three-month membership and you look at the photos. And, you know, I know some women that look at it that way. You know, you're looking for healthy, attractive, fit, and intelligent. So I would want those qualities for my child, the same qualities I would want in a partner.
Right.
They're appealing for people in general.
Yes.
At least that's how I look at it.
For the women's potential partners, partners whom they never meet, the process begins here.
Down here we have the donor rooms where, you know, they can do their thing. And, you know, I'm trying to
book. Suitable pictures on the wall.
Oh, of course, you've got to have a little inspirational material to help it along, you know.
But who are the women going to pick?
It's the same type of room.
Are there any women who say, well, just give me something at random?
Very, very, very rarely.
Okay.
Tell me a woman that has walked into a shoe shop and said, just give me whatever you have. That doesn't happen, you know.
No, that's right. Yeah. But, I mean, I'm interested
anything you
because...
Anything you spend time on your decision.
That's right, of course. But, yeah. I mean, we kind of in our society pay lip service to the idea that there's something taboo about eugenic choice.
Yeah.
And so you might think that the women might, as it were, go along with that and say, well, no, I don't approve of eugenics, so I'm
it's America. It's a society. Yeah.